just being in this church, you know, because you go to different fellowships and it's, I mean, it's awesome and nice and everything, but it's not like your own family, right? It's so different. So last time I was in Garden Hill, I kept getting really sick. Like, I've never been that sick on a trip before. I was sick. I felt like I was sick the whole time. The only time I wasn't sick was going to the service, and then I was okay, and then I had to call home. I called Pastor Chris, and I said, "You need to pray for me. I really don't know if I'm going to make it. I feel like I have to go to the clinic or something." But he prayed, and I said, "I'll go to sleep now, and then I wake up, and I'd be okay, and I'd be ready to go on and minister." And it just kept happening. Different sicknesses, not just one kind. Just it kept coming all weekend. And finally, when I hit the plane, I'm like, finally, I can go home. You know, be in my own house. And I ate really light before I left to get on the plane. And I wanted to be very sick on the plane. The stewardess said, "Are you okay?" And I said, "No, I am not." I was just holding that little white thing. And I said, "Oh my, and this is my nightmare come true." Like I said, I've never wanted to feel like that on the plane. And, you know, and I was able to hold it together. I couldn't put a thing in my mouth. I was with my friend and we drove all the way back from Toronto. We got home at 1:30 in the morning. But you know, the Lord said to me, he said, you know, when you go to do the work for him, you're on a battlefield. You're on the battlefield for my Lord. You know, and in the song we're going to sing, "I'll serve him till I die." And that's what I had said. I said to the Lord, walking out of the plane, I said, "Lord, I don't know if I want to do this anymore, like running around, traveling." But then after I kind of felt a little better by maybe Wednesday after, I said, "Okay, Lord, I'll do it." Because I remember Chris's, all of his afflictions he's had. And I said, "Okay, Paul, go be such a baby and just get on that battlefield again." So I need you guys to stand, and we're going to sing about the battlefield, the key of D. Are you tuned up?
I'm not.
you know, we are here to lift up the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, we're not ashamed of worshiping Him this morning. You know, sometimes it's like, you know, when you haven't exercised for a while and you even find getting out of a chair hard. You know, I feel like that sense in worship and praise. Sometimes you feel like you haven't really gave Him a good praise and worship, you know, unless you do that in your backyard, running around and worshiping, you know. But sometimes it feels like that. Sometimes it feels like we haven't really given God the praise. We haven't really given Him the worship that is due and honored to His name. And sometimes, I'm probably just talking to myself here, is that we have to get all those crinks out. We got to change the atmosphere. Sometimes I say, why do you have to sing that song like 100 times? And I say, because the Lord is changing the atmosphere. You know, He is doing the work. He is changing things around. He's getting our focus off of us and onto Him. Because that is why we're here this morning, to worship the King of Kings.
You shine.
for the Lion of Judah, the seed of Abraham, the Holy One, God, the Holy Son, you are the King of Hosts. You are the King. Thank you.
You know, we've often will hear someone say, "He is here." Worship brings the presence of the Lord. And worship, He's worth it. He's worth it. He's worth it. Worship means He's worth it.
Yes.
And we withhold our worship to the one who is worth it. And we just want to see Him do some miraculous thing. When the miraculous thing is in us. And if we would just worship when we leave here, worship, our lives are worth it to Him. And as frail as we feel, and as frail as we are, give. Only He can give. Why don't we?
back's been, since 2004, my back's been really bothering me. It's my spine. And I prayed, I think it was this morning or yesterday, because it was really bothering me. And I had to take these pills so I could keep moving. And my back started to burn right there on that spot.
Wow.
Just burn.
Praise God.
Yeah. So I'm praying that, you know, I don't feel anything. Of course, I'm not moving around or anything.
Praise God.
Amen. Amen.
I just have to share.
Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Believe the Lord for your healing, Jeanette. Hallelujah. Praise God. Oh, God is so good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Wow. Wow. Well, we've been praying all morning. Wow is not an intelligent thing to say, but sometimes it's the only thing you have to say in the presence of the Lord. Just wow. Those of you joining us online, welcome. Those of you in person, welcome. Let's just bow our heads. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, thank you, Lord, that you inhabit the praises of your people, that as we gather in your holy name, you are here in the midst of us. Lord, you work both within us and around us. Lord, you are so good. Father, in Jesus' name, that Holy Spirit, we give you authority to minister in every place, everyone that is listening. The Holy Spirit, you anoint every ear. Give us ears to hear what you are saying to your church. Give us a mind to understand. And give us a heart to receive. That, Lord, the name of Jesus would be exalted in us and through us. That you, Father, would receive all glory and all praise. For you are worthy. In Jesus' name. Amen. I've been on a subject I've not really enjoyed, but it's necessary. I've been speaking on offense, but I want to speak on the blessing today, finally. But you have to go through an awful lot of offense to get to the blessing. and the offense will keep you from receiving that which God has for you. So if you have your Bible, turn with me to Matthew 11. Verses 4 to 6. Matthew 11, verses 4 to 6. Matthew chapter 11, verses 4 to 6. Hallelujah. I have two scriptures that don't seem like they're related, but I'm going to show you how they are related. The one says what will happen, the other says how it will happen. So we're going to look at the what, then we're going to look at the how. Matthew chapter 11, verses 4 to 6. Jesus answered and said unto them, go and show John again those things which ye do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor gospel preached to them. And blessed is he, whosoever shall not be offended in me. Amen. Blessed is he, whosoever shall not be offended in me. Since Easter, I've been having to speak on offense. And I've tried arguing with God to get out of it, and it doesn't work. Most of you are wise enough to know that you can't argue with God, but sometimes we try, and we hope that it didn't work all the time before, but we hope maybe this time it'll work. Blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. I've had to cover why we get offended. I don't want us to be offended, but there are things that can cause us to be offended. We get offended when God does something that is in our theological box. If my box does not allow God to move in that way, I get offended when he does. And we don't realize that God honors the box, but it does not fit in it. See, anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord, within the context of their understanding, as limited as it might be, he will honor them in that place. But don't be fooled into thinking he will fit. He does not fit in your box. Your box cannot contain him. So sometimes we see God move in a way that we do not understand, and we get upset about it, because we don't think God ought to be moving in that way. And then we go to tell God how he ought to be moving. That doesn't work. We get offended when God works with people we don't think he ought to be working with. We have already made a list in our mind of the qualifications for those that God ought to be working with. And we think, well, that person does not fit in that list. That brother, that sister, they don't fit. They're not proper. They're not right. And God will think otherwise. Hallelujah. Oh my goodness. We get offended by grace. We want grace if it's for us, and yet we get offended when it's given to somebody else. I want grace for me, but I don't like it when it's given to somebody who don't deserve it. Oh, Papa. We get offended by tares. The fact that God is moving and Satan tries to sow tares in the midst of it. He tries to infiltrate what God is doing by sowing tares. They look like the real thing, and yet they don't produce fruit. They're not of God. Yet we see the tares, recognize the lack of fruit, and we get offended. The problem is we tend to get offended at the whole field rather than at the tares. But that's wrong. That's wrong. I love in that parable found in Matthew 13, they ask, Lord, what should we do about them? Shall we pull them up? And the Lord says, no, wait till the harvest. Then it'll all be sorted out. I'm paraphrasing. Don't uproot them now because you'll pull up the wheat. But we can be offended by the tares, by the falsehood of Satan that tends to try and infiltrate the move of the kingdom. See, Jesus said the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. That though it is the smallest of all seeds, when it's planted into a tree, large enough to shade the whole garden, it will provide a refuge for the birds of the air. Now, I like natural birds. But in this case, in the spirit, birds always refer to the demonic. That demons try to hide in the thing that God's doing. That's offensive. But the problem is we tend to get offended by the whole thing rather than by the demons. We should be offended by the move of Satan. But we should not carry offense against the whole field. Yeah. What do I mean by that? I don't have time to go all into this, but I want to explain this. Let's say there's healing. Where the kingdom of God is, there is healing. But Satan sometimes tries to step in and masquerade as a healer. Now, and he doesn't give real healing. He can't do that. But it looks like the real thing. He counterfeits the things of God. See, Satan is not imaginative enough to do his own thing. He counterfeits the things of God. Now, a lot of people then see the counterfeit and get offended by the whole thing. And so, well, there's no healing then because there was this guy and he was a fraud. And so we can be offended by the tares, by the false things that try to sneak in to the move of God. Oh, Papa. We get offended by flesh. We get offended, that's hard to say. We get offended by the flesh. Because the problem is the move of God involves people that are highly imperfect. And that means that your flesh is involved. And sometimes what will be coming out is more fleshly than spiritual. But we control the whole thing because we get offended by the chaff. Because when the fire of the Holy Spirit comes, it exposes the entire thing to the fire of God. Both the wheat and the chaff come wrapped up in the same package. Some of you farmers, you know what I'm talking about. When you go to harvest, there's stuff you don't want, but you harvest the whole thing, knowing that later wheat will come out of it. Right? You harvest the whole thing. You harvest corn, it comes with husks. You don't eat the husks, you eat the corn. But you harvest the whole thing, you cut off the top, you keep it, right? Sometimes we get offended by the husks. We get offended by the chaff because they're not perfect. And sometimes we don't realize in that moment what we are looking at and getting offended by is the mirror. I'm not saying this to insult or offend anyone, but often the very things you get upset with in other people are the very things you get upset with about yourself. And you're looking at someone who's revealing those very things back to you, and you don't like it. But here's the interesting thing. God uses you and me in spite of that. And he exposes the whole thing to his glory so that he can purify it and bring forth goodness. And don't get offended in the meantime. Because Jesus said, blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in him. Amen? I want to focus on blessing. I've had to focus on the offense, and I've had to give a summary today. But I don't want us to get bogged down in the offense. Because there's a blessing. There's a blessing to be had. And it's a blessing, I hope this is not, that will knock your socks off. See, I'm not wearing socks right now, so they're already knocked off. There's a blessing that is coming if you can manage to keep from being offended. I want you to turn to the other passage that gives you the key to not being offended, and it is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I'm talking about spiritual gifts, but I have to talk about something else first. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13. It says, and now abideth faith, hope, and charity, or love, these three. But the greatest of these is charity, or love. Now, growing up, coming from a background where we didn't know anything about the moving of God, we didn't know anything about the kingdom of God, we didn't know anything about the moving of the Holy Spirit, and we thought that was had expired 2,000 years ago, and I remember crying and wishing that it would be for now, not realizing it was for now. We didn't read 1 Corinthians 12 or 14 because it talked too much about the gifts, so we didn't know anything. And they scared us, all right? But we would read 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter, that culminates in this word. Now abides hope, faith, hope, and love, or charity. See, what I didn't understand back then was that all of this is for now, it's for us. And all of this hinges on these three things. See, I'm going to give you a brief overview, okay? 1 Corinthians 12 is a listing of the gifts and how they fit into the body. That there's different gifts, they all fit together. Are you with me? 1 Corinthians 14 is how do they function within that body? How does this work? What does it kind of look like a little bit when you come together for worship? Okay? And then in the middle, there's a love chapter about love. I can have all prophecies. I can know all mysteries. I can speak in every kind of tongue. And yet if I don't have love, I'm nothing. And I'm a clanging, noisy, annoying symbol. I don't have the word annoying, but it's implied. Okay? If I don't have love, and now abides these three, love. See, what I didn't realize was that all of the gifts and all of the moving of the Spirit and all of that glory that Jesus said, blessed is he who's not offended in me, they hinge on these three things. Faith, hope, and love. All of this hinges like a book. A book, if you open it, you have to have binding in the middle. It has to hold it, otherwise it becomes a bunch of pieces of paper and will fall apart. Faith, hope, and love are the keys to walking in the gifts of the Spirit. They're the keys to not being offended. Jesus said, blessed is he who is not offended in me, but blessed is he. These three things open the kingdom of God. They give us access to the blessing, and they keep us from being offended at the same time. Now, I'm going to talk about them one by one because I want us to receive the blessing. I don't want us to be offended, and I want us to be blessed. And I hope that your desire is to be blessed and not offended. But we'll pray for you a little extra if your desire is to be offended. It says, abides these remain, faith, hope, and love. Now, faith, belief in God. Faith has been called the currency of heaven. Faith is how we access the promises of God. In other words, I have to believe it is for me. I have to believe that God said it, and he was speaking to me. And that means I can take it and run with it, because he promised. Now, all the promises of God in Christ Jesus are yes and amen. They are for us, for each and every one of us. That means, now even though I just shared, I didn't know any better, but as I learned, and as the Holy Spirit taught me, and as I saw the move of God happening around me, I realized, wow, this is for me. And it encouraged me to put my faith, and to apply faith, and say, Lord, you have many promises in your word. We heard testimonies today. I'm sorry. Those of you who are online who might have missed some of them. But we heard testimonies today of taking hold of God's promises. Of taking hold of what God has said. Jesus said, tell John the things you do hear and see. The blind receive their sight. The lame walk. The dead are raised. The poor have the gospel preached to them. Hallelujah, that all of these things are happening, and they're happening by the disciples. We are disciples. When we take hold of the promises of God through faith, we believe that it can be applied to us, and that God is desiring to give it to us. That those promises are for Jacques, and for Tim, and for Mike, and for Mark, and for Christopher, and for Deborah, and for Jeannie, and for Chris right here. They are for us. Faith allows me to take and say, God, you promised. All of your promises in Christ Jesus are amen. Because I know the cost paid for them. I know that God was not fooling around when it said these things. Because Jesus took it seriously. God took it seriously. He went to the cross to buy them. The cost. Walking in gifts was the cross of Calvary. Why could lame people be walking and blind people be seeing and people be living and poor people no longer poor? Why could this happen? Because Jesus said, it's going to be put on my bill. It's all going to be put on one bill. And I'm going to pay it for all humanity. I am going to pay the price. We can receive that by faith, saying, Lord, you died for us. You rose for us. By your stripes, we are healed. I love how that word is present tense. We were healed. We are healed. We shall be healed. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10 says, we have been delivered. We are being delivered. We shall yet be delivered. It is current. It is present. It was available in the past. It's available now. It's available for the future. And faith allows me to take hold of it. I receive by faith. In Hebrews it says, without faith it is impossible to please God. For you must believe that he is, and is a rewarder of them who diligently seek him. That I'm going to come to him believing. I believe you have a promise for me. And I believe you are a keeper of all of your promises. Because all of your promises in Christ Jesus are yes and amen. Faith is the first key. You have to believe they are, and you have to believe they apply to you. Once you do that, you're going to see God move in your life in amazing ways as you step out in faith. That's not saying it's going to be easy, but you will see God do amazing things in your life. The first key is faith. Now you also have to understand, faith is an offense to unbelief. Faith will offend unbelief every time. Unbelief, there's nothing worse than having your unbelief disturbed by faith. It throws everything out the window. I don't know if there was a window, but it just got thrown out there. When you believe something, it's going to offend doubt and unbelief. But it overrides those things. I believe, and so you can take hold. Not everyone's going to want to come with you. Not everyone's going to believe you. But for those who do, they will be blessed with you. To as many as who are not offended, they shall be blessed. If you can grab hold in faith.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
If you can grab hold in faith. I love what Smith Wigglesworth said. He said, Lord, you said it. I believe it. That's it. Done. I'm believing. You said it. I believe it. That settles it. End of discussion. God said. We can take hold faith of the promises of God. Then we see the gifts manifest in His people. Through us. That means us. His people is a fancy theological word for you and me. Amen?
Amen.
Now abideth faith and hope. Why hope? You see, hope says that things the way they are now is not the way they're always going to be. That I see one situation with my eyes, but I'm hoping and believing for something better that is not seen. See, in Hebrews chapter 11, we don't have time to go through all of it, but it says, you know, faith, substance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. Hope, the faith leads me into hope. I believe God, and therefore things will not always be the way they are now. That doesn't mean you don't acknowledge the way it is now, but it means you look past it. I see, if I walk the streets of Sturton Falls, I see lost people. I see people bound in addiction. I see homeless men and women. I see young people so high on drugs, they don't even know which end is up anymore. I see people so messed up. I see elderly people who have walked in one way all of their lives and they're one step away from the grave and hell. I see young people being born into a world that wants to devour them and swallow them up.
Yes.
But I believe that when Jesus said, pray that your kingdom come, let your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. That means that addictions don't belong in heaven. Nobody's addicted in heaven.
Amen.
Nobody's homeless in heaven.
Amen.
Nobody's sick and suffering in heaven. There are no elderly people in loneliness cast away by their own families. There are no children being offered up in abortion. There are none of those things in heaven. And the Lord said, pray that the kingdom of God will come here as it is in heaven. That means that this ignites a hope within me. That, Lord, I want to see your kingdom come. I want to see it here as it is in heaven. And so therefore, I'm going to do whatever you tell me to do. I can't change everyone. I can't talk to everyone. I can't go everywhere. But Lord, you can. And you can use me. As amazingly, ridiculously imperfect as I am, you can use me. One step, one moment, one word at a time. That I can pray for one sick person and expect to see healing flow out of me. Because, Lord, you have worked to put healing in me. Lord, you will give a prophetic word for that person. You will speak into that life and you're going to set somebody free through me. But I hope. I believe God, his promises. And then I receive that into me. And I release the same in hope. That Sturgeon Falls will not look the same one day. That Noelleville will not same one day. That Warren won't look the same one day. That people will know to call on the name of Jesus. That those bound in depression will be set free. Those bound in addiction will be set free. Those who are lost will be set free. The lonely will be put in families in a place where they are loved. Amen. I believe that. It doesn't mean I don't acknowledge what is happening. I do. But I look past it. I say, Lord, you have a better plan for Sturgeon Falls than that. You have a better plan for Nipissing First Nation than that. You have a better plan for Hamilton, every city on the face of the earth than that. And I'm looking forward to your kingdom, even though I'm only a sojourner and a pilgrim here. But I am here to bring forth your kingdom. And I take hold of it and release it in hope for the better to come. In Hebrews 11, it said, they looked for a city, a better city, a city made without hands, a heavenly one. We hold on through faith and we go on in hope. And the last one, charity or love. I love this word. There is a Greek word. I don't study Greek. So when I say it's Greek to me, it means I don't understand. My apologies to any of you who are Greek. And do understand. There is a Greek word, though, called charis. In English, it would be charis, but they pronounce it charis. And charis means grace and love. And so the gifts of the Spirit are called the charis mata, the gifts of grace and love. The manifestation of grace and love poured out. Which means all of the gifts are given in love. They're given first by God who loves us. For John says, not that we love, but that he loved us and gave himself for us. That God loves us, and so he gave us gifts. And then because he loves us and we are partaking of his love, that love extends beyond me. That I can be a vessel of his love. You can be a vessel of his love. Pouring out through you. That you love beyond what is easy to love, what is natural to love, but it comes out of you. And this is going to stretch you. Again, this will challenge some people. Just like faith is an offense to unbelief, hope is an offense to realists. Because they stop at what they see. Love is an offense where there's no love. It's an offense to hate. And it will stretch us to love that which is not naturally lovable. It is calling us to say, Lord, I need your love at work within me to love that which I cannot love naturally. To love the unlovable, to love the stinky, the sick, those you wouldn't love. See, here's the thing. I'm keeping it here, but if you want to see sick people healed, you got to minister to sick people. If you want to see lost people saved, you have to go minister to lost people. You want to see the dead raised up, guess what? It involves a dead guy or girl. If you want to see God, if you want to see people free from the demonic, you're going to have to call upon the name of the Lord. Amen. To stand in courage. Yeah. To love someone who needs to be set free, who yes. needs to be saved, who needs to be healed, who needs to be raised up. Love does that. You see, selfishness says, I don't want to touch that. So I'm going to put that over there. I don't want to come near that. I'm going to leave it over there. Oh, it goes back ahead. He's over there. Forgot about that. And them. Selfishness says, I'm going to keep it all for me. Love says, I see people around me in need. Yeah. And I'm not going to shut my heart up to them. No. I am going to walk with Jesus. I'm going to walk by the power of the Holy Spirit and release the kingdom of God here in faith, in hope, and in love. And here's the amazing thing. It's going to be hard. Okay? Again, I'm forgive me if I'm going to keep it real here, but you're going to have to go up to the sick person and pray for them.
Right.
Some of you might have a fear of doing that.
Yeah.
Okay? I don't really want to, Lord. But what you do, and you just feel the Lord saying they're going to be healed, but I need you to go up there, lay hands on them, and pray over them.
Amen.
And you say, Lord, I don't know anything about that. I mean, I don't really want to see them. When you can step out And when you can do that, and you see the hand of God move in your life, because you stepped out in faith, in hope, and in love, even though you didn't feel it, and you went out, and you see them healed, and they experience the power of God, you're going to be so excited, you're going to have to tie a rope to your feet to hold you down. Because you're going to see the glory of God released through you.
Amen.
What if, I mean, pray this doesn't happen, but you saw God heal somebody through you? What if you saw somebody raised from the dead through you? What if you got to lead a person to Jesus?
Amen.
What if you cast out a demon in the name of Jesus?
Amen.
And you saw the of God work through you. Do you know how blessed you're going to be?
Amen.
And how much you're going to be telling everybody?
Amen.
Jesus did this through me.
Amen.
Highly messed up, imperfect me. But Jesus did it through me. Jesus, you. See, blessed is anyone who does not get offended in me. And church, I want you to walk in the blessing. To believe that these promises of God, this sign shall follow them that believe. In my name, for they cast out demons. In my name, will they speak with new tongues. They will take serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it will not hurt them. If they lay hands on the sick, they will recover. To believe that these promises are for you, they're for Clarice,
amen,
they're for Mike, they're for Ralph, they're for Mark, they're for Neluka, they're for Christopher, they're for every single one of us. Because you believe. Are you ready for that kind of blessing? Are you ready for that? Because, like I said, you're so high. There's a saying, there's no high like the Most High. You're going to be so excited in the Lord. Nobody's going to be able to steal your blessing. If you're ready for it, to not be offended. To be inoffendable in love. Watch and see what God's going to do. It's going to be the simplest, smallest of things. Just going over and talk to your neighbor. It's usually not much that the Lord asks. He asks, just go there. And watch what I'm going to do when you go there.
Yeah,
are you ready for the blessing?
Yeah.
I want us all to stand if you're ready for the blessing. Because these three things unlock the blessing of the Lord. I don't have time to go into all of it. But if and as we grow in these things, there is a blessing coming, not only to you, but to all of this region. Amen? So let's pray and be ready to receive what God wants to do and be ready to release what God wants to do. Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus. Father, we are believing in your promises for us, for each and every one of us. That your promises in Christ Jesus are yes and amen. Because he shed blood on the cross for each of them to be made true, to be accomplished. The price has been paid. Lord, we're looking to you in faith and we're receiving from you in faith and we're releasing from you in faith. Lord, in hope that our world, our families, our neighbors won't be as they are. In the midst of the brokenness, in the midst of the pain, midst of the sickness and the suffering and everything else, your kingdom will come in the midst,
yes,
and your glory will be seen on them, and they will praise your holy name because they experienced you through us. Lord, we want to walk in this faith and hope. And Father, we want to walk in your love, your wonderful, overwhelming love, Lord God, that knows no bounds. Lord, help us to love that it is not even lovable, Lord God.
Yes.
As you first loved us when
yes,
we were not lovable
yes,
at all. Lord, help us to walk in that kind of faith, in that kind of hope, and in that kind of love. That, Lord, will be blessed
yes,
along with the many hundreds and thousands. And, Lord, I believe for millions who will be blessed because of you, Lord. Thank you, Father, that you have positioned us for this. Lord, teach us, guide us. Grow us, shape us. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and for the blessing you are about to pour out.
Yes, Jesus.
Father, help us to receive it. Help us to release it to those around us. Help us to believe you that your word is true and all your promises are yes and amen. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, we are believing and receiving and ready to be releasing. Amen and amen and amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
The Lord bless you all. The Lord keep you all. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you, and give you peace. Amen.
Not to you.
Amen.